sta in ihdinas siratal mustaqim siratal ladhina an'amta alayhim ghayril maghdubi alayhim بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله الكريم وعلى أهله وأصحابه أجمعين أما بعد And that is with the name of Allah, the merciful benefactor, the merciful redeemer. We ask Allah to send his choicest blessings upon the honorable messenger of Allah, that's Muhammad ibn Abdullah, and that we also ask him to send his choicest blessing upon his family, upon his companions, upon all the righteous servers, servants of Allah and the believers. Today at Masjid Wali Muhammad, we're having the youth Ta'aleen of the Detroit area youth group of the Muslim American Society. And we have two speakers today, one young brother and one young sister. And I hear that the you say that our youth is our future. And it's our hope. And so we're going to hear first from Brother Liddell, and he's going to be addressing us first about knowledge. So, Brother Liddell can come up. Assalamu alaikum.
With the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, I bear witness that there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is His servant and His messenger. As-salamu alaykum. Okay, the issue that I will be talking about is knowledge is power. So we all can relate to that because knowledge is powerful in the fact that it gives you a clear understanding of things that are going on around you. A person without knowledge is a person that is lost and in a sense living in the darkness. Without knowledge, you are vulnerable and you can be easily manipulated by anyone who does have knowledge of the smallest thing. For example, if you have no knowledge of anything, but you're talking with someone who has the smallest amount of knowledge about it, that person talking to you will appear to be some sort of a genius, when really they don't know anything. But because you don't know either, you know, they seem to know more than what they really do know. And they will try to manipulate you and mislead you accordingly. So it is important that you be a studious person and not just take people's word for it. They may be trustworthy and honorable and so on and so forth, but it's only logical that you study and research what they say because they may be wrong. They may be wrong and they may not know that they're wrong. So they may, I would appreciate it if I say anything wrong today that anyone who knows my error tells me about it so I can correct it the next time. And that will help me develop. So, you know, it's important that we be studious people. We can't just be blind followers and just go for anything that I tell you, because that's not intelligent. And we are trying to be intelligent people. So it is imperative that we seek knowledge from the cradle to the grave, as it said. And the most powerful and beneficial knowledge is the knowledge of Al-Islam. Because once you get the understanding that there is nothing greater than you on this planet except Allah, then nothing really can stop you. You fear nothing. You fear no man because you know that nothing that they do will affect you. They can plot and plan all they want, but Allah plans also. So it matters not. So you understand that, you know, when you see someone doing well, you'll congratulate them instead of being that crab in the barrel and saying, oh man, they doing, you know, I don't like that. I wish that I can do that. Because you have that same potential to do it also. There is nothing stopping you from reaching the highest level except for yourself. Because the reality is that you get out whatever you put in. If you put nothing into something, don't expect to get everything out of it. I mean, that's against logic. You know, I'm trying to be a logical person. Now, you know, if you don't study for a test, you can't expect to get it. A on the test, you know, because you didn't study, so you're not prepared. So you must understand that you get out what you put in, and you limit yourself. It is you who set those limitations. So if you understand that there is nothing greater than you on this planet except Allah, and you understand that anything that He wills for you will be, then you just get out and do what you have to do. And leave it all to Allah. And I remember once while I was riding with Brother Tawheed and his grandson, and his grandson asked, you know, he said, "Granddaddy, what is the most powerful weapon on the planet?" So, you know, it was a moment of silence. I was thinking about it. Brother Tawheed was thinking about it. And then I just said, "Your mind is the most powerful weapon on the planet. Your mind. Something as simple as your mind is the most powerful weapon on the planet. Because everything that you see around you comes from an idea first. It is first a concept, a thought. Then you get other people around you who want to work with you, and they, you know, adapt that thought as if it was a thought of their own. So then you all put together in which your thoughts come action. So then that's how things begin to develop and build. Because if I get you to believe an idea that I have as if it was your own idea, then we work excellently. Because, see, I didn't have to force you. I didn't force my ideas on you. I simply presented the information to you, and you began to think about it. That's all it takes, a thought first. It starts with your mind. And then, you know, if you think about something hard enough, if you get enough people to believe in something, they will change. They will change things. Because, like I said, knowledge is power, and the fact that once you become knowledgeable of something, you no longer accept the low standards that are given to you. If what you're getting is not up to par to what your equal share, then you won't accept it. Because you know better. You know that you deserve better. You understand that you should have better. There is no reason that you shouldn't. There is no reason that you shouldn't. So once you come into knowledge, you understand that, you know, you refuse limitations that other people set on you. People will estimate you. They will say, "Well, okay, I doubt if you can do anything. You probably, you know, because..." They don't see your potential because they themselves have limited vision. They are not Allah. They don't know what you can do. Because like I said previously, there is nothing on this planet that's greater than you. Nothing. So don't let anyone tell you that, okay, well, because you're a high school student or you're so young, you don't know anything. Because the reality is that they don't know anything. How can they tell you when they don't know themselves? You know, that's not intelligent. So don't become discouraged by others who doubt their own selves. They doubt themselves, so therefore they doubt you. They say, because I can't accomplish something, I couldn't accomplish that. When I was that age, you can't do it either. They sum you up like that. That's not fair, and that's not good, because you cannot say just because, you know, everyone's struggle is different. That's reality. Everyone's struggle is different. I may have trouble with math, you may be good in math. But just because I'm having difficulty with math, that doesn't mean that I should say, well, this brother here, he can't do a calculus either. Because that's not good. Who am I to sum you up like that? I'm no one. My vision is limited also. You know, I would discuss with people when I would go up to the University of Michigan visiting college campuses. You know, many of them are confused and lost on the whole concept of there being a supreme being or existing. They don't understand that. You know, the guy told me, he says that I'm only a man. I will never have enough time to understand or have that idea of a God or a supreme being existing. He says that he's limited. He pointed to me, he pointed to the sheet of paper that was on his desk. He says, look at this. It was a laminated sheet of paper. And he said, I have to look at this sheet of paper. Then I have to think about the molecules, you know, that cause, you know, when you have to, something he was trying to say. But basically, in his own statement, he pointed out his limitation. So that shows you that there is something greater than you because you've noticed your own limitations. That only makes sense. I know that I can't see through walls because I'm limited. So I know that there is something greater than me that can see through these things. It's purely logical. But a lot of people don't use their brains. They're confused. They're lost. They need to be shown. It's up to us to show these people the right way because they're blind. And men, you know, ignorance is bliss. People enjoy ignorance. It's fun for them, so-called fun, because that fun is destroying your mind. drinking alcohol, that stuff is poison. I learned about that in chemistry. It is poison. But we, you know, we indulge in it and we drink it. And we destroy ourselves because we've been trained. We've been trained a certain way. We're not supposed to use our mind. You see, you have a lock on your mind that's invisible if you're not a thinker. If you just follow and believe anything that anyone tells you, then there is a lock there. And it's up to you to break it. Like they say, we're still dealing with ghosts from slavery. I focus on African Americans because I am an African American. I mean, if that's wrong, I apologize. But I can't worry about what's wrong with you or your people, you know, as much. I can have compassion, I can feel for you and your people, but I have to first address what's happening with me. I can't come over your house, make up your bed, when my stuff is dirty. My stuff is not together. I can't do that. That doesn't make sense to me. And if you have a problem with it, I apologize. I can't do that. So, you know, knowledge is powerful. Because, like I said, you don't accept those limitations, and you won't allow other people to limit yourself. You know, you don't let them tell you, well, you can only do so much, you can't do this, because you can. It just takes a little more work, that's all. Like I said, you get out what you put in, and you have to put in the work if you want the results. You can't just expect something to just drop in your lap, and it's just, okay, well, this is it, I got it now, you know. No work involved. That's not reality. That's not true. Life is, as they say, a test. And you will be held accountable for everything that you say and everything that you do. You're responsible for it. And like I said, I advise everyone to not just take people's word for it. Because they can make mistakes. They're human. Anything that breathes oxygen can let you down. My father told me that. My father says, you know, I love you, son, but I can make mistakes. I can forget, you know, I mean... He says he's going to do something for me. I'm sure he wants to. But he can make mistakes. Anything that breathes oxygen can let you down. Because we're not invaluable. We make errors. Right. We make mistakes. But we learn and we keep moving and we try to improve ourselves. We try to go back. That's why I say, if I make any mistakes now, please tell me afterwards. Pull me to the side. Because it's important. Because if you care for me, if you care for me as your brother, you will help me in my errors. You will tell me, say, well, brother, you shouldn't have did this that way, you know, because I will know better next time and I will be more developed. But we have people around here who figure, like I said, they know a little bit about nothing, you know, so they want to pretend, okay, I'm the man, when they don't know anything. But because they talk to people who don't know anything either, you know, they appear to be the man. So if my audience is full of, you know, derelicts, they're not intelligent. You know, my audience is full of idiots. I'm going to appear to be a genius. But I won't go around the knowledgeable people. I will stay around those who make me feel like I'm a genius. That's an ego thing. I will stay around those who praise me and say, hey, this brother is phenomenal. You know, I'm going to do that.
That's right.
I'm going to stay over there. Because you don't want to go around, you know, make yourself seem small. If somebody knows more about what I'm saying than me, I'm not gonna go around that because they will, you know, expose my weakness. They will expose me as the fake that I am. But if I know I have people who don't study, they just, if I say I said it, I researched it, and they say, okay, I got it made. I got me a group of zombies, my own people, because I control their mind.
That's right.
The mind is the most powerful weapon on this planet, and if I control your mind, then I control you. And it's not difficult to see that a lot of people's minds are being controlled. Look around. African American people are walking billboards. We work for these people. We pay them to work for them.
Yes, sir.
I'm going to buy your clothes so I can show other people what you have made so they want to go buy it, so I'm working for you.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm paying you to do that. I'm making you rich while I'm doing this.
Yes, sir.
Now what type of sense does that make? Well, because we don't think, we don't use our minds, we let other people tell us what to do, we have no problem.
That's right.
And they love us. They love us for making them rich. Because we don't want to do our own thing. We don't want to have our own businesses. We work? What? I want to style, so-called style. I mean, come on, man, let's be for real. If I buy all these chains to show that I have money, The reality is the person who sold me the chains is the one who has the money, not me. That's reality, but we don't think like that. We don't use our minds. We say, hey, it's called conspicuous consumption. I learned that in economics. I'm going to buy what I have to show other people. That's the only reason why I bought it, to show y'all, so y'all can want to go get it. And I'm working for the people, you know, they have a free employee. They don't have to pay me, I'll pay them to work for them.
Yeah.
Now that makes no sense to me, but hey, people do it. You know what I mean? They don't use their minds. We have a society filled with zombies, and we have to deal with that. We have to, in a sense, sort of resurrect the dead. It's hard. It's hard because, like me and this guy at my job would talk, I would say, you know, he would ask me a question, you know, sort of, I guess, brain teaser or whatever. And I would ask him, I would say, how do you convince a blind man that he can't see? These people are blind, but they're telling you, I can see. I can see, but they are blind. They see nothing, but they telling you, I can see, you know, this is the most important thing to me, but they're blind. They how can you do that? It's like you have to recapture their minds because they have locks. They're limited. Their vision is limited. Mm-hmm. They have wool over their eyes, as they used to say.
That's right.
They have that wool over them, and they can't see. They can't think. So we have to get into the psychological aspect and figure out how can we recapture our people's mind, because it's gone.
It is
gone. Your mind is gone when you know that this is poison, but I still want more anyway. When you try to tell me that it is poison, I say, no, I don't want to know about that. Don't tell me what's in the food that I'm eating, because I'm not going to like it anymore. I don't like that food. I mean, you know, you destroy that bliss for them. If I tell you, man, you don't want to know what corned beef is. You don't want to know what part of the cow that is. You know, don't tell me, because, you know, I enjoy corned beef. That's what they tell you. Don't tell me, because I won't want to eat it anymore. Ignorance is bliss. Ignorance is bliss. It's fun. I mean, don't tell me what are the ingredients that I have in the food that I'm eating. I tell people all the time, I wouldn't eat that if I was you. I would not eat that if I was you. But they do it anyway. My uncle. I don't mean to put him out there, but my uncle. Me and him, we went to go visit my father. My father's like a vegetarian or something. And he was telling them, you know, what's in the ham and stuff. He like, well, I'm still gonna eat my ham sandwich and my bologna. You know, they don't want to know. They don't want to. It's killing them. They named us right, soul food. Soul, because you certainly will die. You will, because it's scraps. Let's look at it for what it really is.
Yes,
do you think they would give these slaves gourmet meals? That's not reality. They gave them scraps. We're eating chitterlings and chitlins and pig feet. What? That is nasty. That's disgusting. But we have no knowledge, so we do it. And then when you present them with the knowledge, they don't want it. They run away from it. This one brother told me, he was a black man. And I'm going to tell y'all, some of the biggest white supremacists are black people.
Uh-huh.
I'm going to tell y'all that. Because he told me, he says, the best way to hide something from a black man is put it in a book. Because he won't touch the book. He won't touch that book. He won't open that book up, but he will take everything else but a book. And that hurt. Because I knew he was telling the truth.
Mm-hmm.
As they say, the truth hurts. And we have to become more studious people. We do. And back to my previous point of us being the biggest white supremacists, is, you know, a lot of people don't see it. You know, you have to point it to them because they're unaware. Like a lot of people change their eye color with contacts and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Dark as you want to be with purple eyes. That makes no sense to me. You see, you have purple and blue eyes. Why can't you accept the way that Allah made you? You're beautiful. You are beautiful. That's why I go to public school, so I see it all.
Yes, sir.
It's pitiful. It's sad. It hurts me to see people ashamed of themselves subconsciously. They don't even know it. They don't realize the seriousness of what they're doing. They don't know. So I try to talk with them and tell them. Some of them still don't understand. They still do not understand that this stuff is being, it's been put into us. We don't want this. You know, I tell them I have pretty eyes too. My eyes may not be blue, Because what they consider to be pretty is the eyes of a Caucasian. Light blue, green, hazel brown. Let's draw the picture. I want my baby to have pretty eyes. Please let my baby have pretty eyes. Good hair. So-called good hair, and I want him to be light-skinned. I have nothing against light-skinned people. Don't get me wrong. But what I'm saying is this. When you wish for that, you paint that picture on this board over here, and you look at the person who wants that to look like that, and you will see that they look nothing like that. I'm dark as I want to be, but I want my baby to have so-called good hair. That's pitiful.
Yeah.
That's sad, because all hair is good hair. I mean, if we really understood our nature, that's where knowledge of self is important. Because this here, as they say, nappy, this is good. Because it protected us.
Yes,
it protected us. But how many of us know that? How many of us know that? Not many. Because we don't study anything. We won't read a book.
That's
if it's not in a song on TV, I never came across it. I never came across it. I'm sorry. I am sorry. I never got there.
Yes, sir.
And that's not good. That's not good. That's why we must read books. Don't read. I mean, it will tell you all the information is there for you, but you never read and you never learned about it, so you don't know. Because they will, you know, they will say, okay, we had this available, but you just never researched to find it. Because I'm not, if I don't like you, I'm not going to say, well, here are all these opportunities for you. Just like with the situation with affirmative action. I was reading this book because I'm doing a research paper on affirmative action, and the reality is that they have been having affirmative action for Caucasians forever. Since the New Deal. See, they don't mention that, though. It's a problem when the benefactors are minorities or African Americans. You know, you can't have anything. You can't know. You know, they give reparations for every other people except for us. How can you know, extradite ex-Nazi war criminals? What are you going to do to yourselves? That's my question. What are you going to do to yourselves? Because, I mean, you know, no disrespect to the Jews or to the Holocaust, but it wasn't as bad as slavery to me. I'm sorry. I can, like I said, I can show you a little sympathy, but I can't, you know, get out there and demonstrate and cry for you because I still haven't had my reparations yet. I haven't been taken care of. They say, I mean, it may be selfish. I don't know. I don't know. I'm trying to deal with reality. Knowledge is powerful, and once you come into knowledge, it's beautiful, because it's like when you're doing something wrong and you don't know that it's wrong, then once you realize that what you were doing was wrong, then you will certainly, you know, want to correct it. Because if what I'm doing is wrong, I don't want to do that intentionally. That's when you deal with that whole concept that men are created evil and all that stuff. That's not reality for me. Me and my teacher, my English teacher, will talk about it. She would say that all men are created evil and original sin and so on and so forth. But to me, I mean, how can you tell a baby he's just born evil? That's depressing. I just look at you, you're just evil. That's depressing. That's not encouragement. You should not do that to anyone. Tell them it's your nature. You're evil in nature. It's your free will. You chose to be wrong. That's your choice. I didn't make you do that. Shows that you weren't born like that. That was your choice. It was your option. That's on you, not on the creator. You know, so I don't know. But many people won't research and study nothing. I try to form study groups. See how many people come. Throw a party. See how many people come. See the difference. Serious, because we live in a society that downplays education. We downplay it, and then the education that we do get is not completely true. They told me when I was little, Christopher Columbus discovered America. Now, you know, when I was little, I didn't really understand what they were saying to me. I'm like, Christopher Columbus discovered America, but it was people already here. You know, when you little, you question it, but you don't go no further than that, because this is my teacher, they're teaching me right. They have no reason about me, but it's a hidden agenda. They do have a reason. Because they don't want you to have any knowledge of yourself.
Mm-hmm.
They don't want you to. Christopher Columbus, how can I discover a place with people already? Everybody knows that it's not true, but how many of us go further to see who did really discover America? So you can teach your little children, say, well, no, Christopher Columbus didn't discover America, so on and so forth. This is how it was discovered. Mm-hmm. Not by Christopher Columbus, the great explorer, so-called. Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir.
That's just a lie. Mm-hmm. And but we accept it. We go for it. Anything that they feed you, you just take it. We just take it. Anything. Thanksgiving. The holidays, even. Like I said, ignorance is bliss. A person got angry with me because I don't celebrate, you know, Thanksgiving and Halloween and all that stuff. Because for me, I don't look at what we have made it mean. I look at what the original meaning behind it was. You see, they met with those people to murder them. They gave them blankets and turkeys. The blankets had diseases, smallpox. That's what they had. So the reality is that the Europeans did not like the Native Americans. They called them savages. Yes. They portrayed the Native Americans as who they were in the mirror. That's reality. The Europeans were the savages. But if you have no knowledge of history, you don't know that.
That's right.
You don't know that. And I would invite anyone to research what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. And look at it for what it really is. Don't make it mean anything for yourself. Mm-hmm. Christmas is a pagan festival known as Saturnalia. That's the reality. It, you know, when I was little, I was wondering, because I wasn't born Muslim, okay? When I was little, I would wonder, what does me exchanging a gift have to do with Christ's birthday? But the reality is, what does Christ's birthday have to do with me exchanging this gift? Because Saturnalia, they exchange gifts, and it happened towards the end of December. So I was doing exactly what I was supposed to be doing, but I didn't know it. I thought it was Christmas. They told me it was Christmas. It's Saturnalia. See, if you have knowledge of Roman history, then you understand America pretty well. Because they get a lot of that stuff from the Romans. Yes, I guarantee you that.
That's right.
Look at all their monuments. They have Latin on them and things of that nature. So knowledge is important. Knowledge of anything is important. Mm-hmm. And you know, people will get angry. But you know what I noticed is this. In school, people are asking, what are you getting for Christmas? Not how are you going to, you know, go for it, as it being Christ's birthday. They don't care about that. They care about the gifts. I did. I'm not gonna lie. I'm trying to get a, you know, when I was younger, Nintendos and Genesis that just came up. That's what I wanted. I wanted a Genesis. I didn't care nothing about no birthday and nobody. Just give me my Genesis.
Yes, sir.
Because that's how they get you when you're little, with the material things. With Halloween, it's the candy. I want a whole lot of candy. Mm-hmm. That's all that you want, is the candy. You don't think about nothing else but the candy. That's not the actual meaning behind it. So they get you like that. Mm-hmm. But we aren't thinkers anymore. I don't know what happened, and I don't know what it's going to take to, I mean, what does it take, really, to wake these people back up? People have been saying this for years. I study, I read old books written 30 years ago. It sounds like they were written yesterday.
Yes, sir.
It sounds like they were written yesterday because we are in this, it's like a movie. The same script, different cast.
Mm-hmm.
That shows you that nothing has changed because the same people that were on the bottom 20 years ago are on the bottom right now.
Mm-hmm.
That's reality.
Yes, sir.
We're still on the bottom. Don't think because you have a Cadillac, you made it. No. Because your people are still at the bottom, suffering.
That's right.
They're still suffering. And we have to make a change. Mm-hmm. It's necessary. Or we won't make it. If you don't wake up, it's sad. It's sad how many of our youth are gone. I'm trying to bring them back. I'm trying.
Yes,
I can only do so much.
Yes,
I can only do so much because we're lost. Zombies, the walking dead. They're alive, they're breathing, but their brain is dead.
That's right.
Because they don't use it. They don't think it. And I don't know. What is it going to take? What do we have to do to them? I mean, you don't want to force it on them. You want it to come natural. But they love being a slave. They will fight you if you try to take them chains off.
That's right.
I love my chains. Get away from me. Get away from me. I'm going to go get the mask on you in a second. And we're no threat. We're no threat yet. As soon as you get enough people listening, and you get enough minds thinking, that's when we'll have trouble.
That's right.
That's when we'll have trouble because If I'm a rich man and you're causing me to lose my money, I'm not gonna just let you make me broke. I'm not gonna do that. But see, they have the system set up so well now, and it's been going for so long, they don't have to work too hard, because we do it. Like I said, black people are the biggest white supremacists. We hate ourselves.
Yes,
because we don't know ourselves. And that's not good. When you don't know yourself, but you know everything about every other person, that's not good. But they know all about us.
All right.
And I would wonder, I'm like, why do people not like us? What have we done to them?
Mm-hmm.
We've done nothing. They just know who we are.
Yes.
They know what we can do.
Mm-hmm.
So I have to keep you down. Because if you finally realize what you can do, there will be a change.
Yeah.
And I won't be on top anymore.
Mm-hmm.
They don't want that.
That's right.
That's reality. I don't know. You have to do something.
That's
I know
it.
I'm trying.
Well,
I'm not going to just be this. I can't because, like this brother once told me, now this comes responsibility. What I know has obligated me to teach.
Mm-hmm.
That's reality.
Yes, sir.
What I know has obligated me to teach. I want to share it with people. I want them to see the beauty of what I have learned.
Mm-hmm.
I can't just hide it and hog it for myself. That wouldn't be right.
That's right.
That's right.
Because I know that they don't know yet. Now, once I give it to them, you know, the slaves are going to run away because they hate knowledge.
Yes.
But I know that for every person who doesn't listen to me, there's somebody who stores it here.
Yes, sir.
And inshallah, it will grow. And they may not understand now, but 5 or 10 years from now, maybe they will.
Inshallah.
Maybe we can do something. Because it's time for a change. It's time for it. It's the new millennium, as they say.
That's right.
We have to change. Knowledge is powerful.
So, yes, it is.
Destroy that ignorance and just learn as much as possible, be studious as possible, and never just accept anything that anyone tells you, because anything that breathes oxygen can let you down and can be wrong, because only Allah knows. We don't. That's reality.
Yes, sir.
That's right.
Time is up. Slow down.
Tech beer.
Experts on your health, home, family, food, and finances. Did you know that taking a test before your child is born may improve the odds of your child doing well on tests?
That food allergies may make it harder to lose weight?
Or that there's a new technique to treat snoring?
Consumer Science News and Notes will explain these interesting facts and offer useful and intriguing information.
Keep a pen and paper handy. During the program, we will tell you where to send for free brochures and information packets.
The United States Fire Administration offers a few tips to help prevent fires at your home. First, don't use a kitchen oven range to heat your home during colder weather. Oven ranges can be a fire hazard and a source of toxic fumes. Keep space heaters and wood stoves at least 3 feet from anything combustible. Make sure wood stoves have proper floor support and adequate ventilation. Fireplaces must have a glass or metal screen to prevent sparks from igniting nearby carpets and furniture. Be sure that all furnace controls and emergency shutoffs work well. Leave furnace repairs to qualified specialists. Never leave cooking unattended. Double check to see that all appliances are off before going to bed or leaving the house. For more fire safety information, visit the United States Fire Administration at www.usfa.fema.gov.
Created was the human intellect. And he also said that knowledge is the lost property of the believer.
Yes, sir.
And the prophet's last sermon, he says that your property and your blood is sacred. So to the Muslim, our knowledge is our property that we have lost, and it's sacred to us, and we need to reclaim it. So that's very inspiring words, brother. Our next speaker is Sister Noor. Ready, sister? Come on up.
Today, I just have some inspirational words, hoping, inshallah. I don't have a title. I'm kind of known as the oddball going against the norm. So if it goes to me a title, I apologize. I do want to say, since we're in the month of Ramadan, I want to say something that reflects on that. In the Quran, it says Ramadan is the month in which the Quran was sent down as a guide to mankind. Also clear signs for guidance and judgment between right and wrong. And it goes on to say in another ayah, O you who believe, fasting is prescribed to you as it was prescribed to those before you, that you may learn self-restraint. We should look at Ramadan as a blessing and not as a burden, for Allah has made fasting easy to practice and a spiritual benefit for you and myself. So I want to say let's glorify Allah this time as he has guided you and me, perchance that we may be grateful to him. Now, getting into my subject. I have brought up a question to myself and a few of my friends. I asked, where are the new Muslims? I haven't seen much faces in the mosque like in the past. But I do remember times where, I mean, it was at least five new shahadas each week at the mosques, and now they're gone, and I haven't seen new faces in the mosque, like I said, in the past. And you know what? Most of my friends thought the same. Yeah, where are the new Muslim faces? You know, we see the same old faces every day, and we're seeing less and less of young Muslims also. So we're trying to figure out what is the problem. And by doing that, we try to reflect on, well, how we became Muslims. Now, most of us grew up as Muslims or have Muslim families and stuff, but for those of us who didn't live our lives and grew up as Muslims, we had a different story. It's like when, I'm getting a little nervous, so you guys have to excuse me. No, we do have a different story. It was like, well, maybe we didn't want Islam, you know. Okay. I can go back a little bit. So, why didn't we see much new faces trying to learn Islam as we did? Or we can say, well, maybe they didn't want the truth. That's where we're getting from. Maybe they didn't want the truth, and you know that could be right. Maybe they didn't want the truth. And there's other reasons we can say why people didn't want Islam. And those reasons can be right, too. And then the question was brought up of those faces we did want to see. Where are they going? And when will they return? Now, if we thought we can bring up these questions, we could then try to understand the problems and then work towards the solutions. So then is when we reflected on when we became Muslim. And like I was saying, for those who did not grow up as Muslims, you know how I kind of start off with the curiosity, like you either read a book or seen something on TV or seen the movie Malcolm X, with all my friends. I was in high school, and it was, I think, ninth grade. We all skipped school. Even the teachers just go see Malcolm X. And maybe that might be something that caught an interest about Islam. And then to feed in more our curiosity, we try to find an outlet to feed, you know, into that. So we at least try to find something, a place or a person, and usually we find, like, a Muslim, you know, which then leads us to that place of being a mosque. And, like, when we're there, it's just like,
You know how you say, you know, I'm just here studying, you know, I ain't trying to be learning Islam, you know, I'm into a lot of stuff, you know. So we kind of put on right, I ain't trying. But for those of us, we do stay and accept Islam, and we want more of this. Then that person like takes the Shahada, and everything that they were studying before becomes a clear reality to them. And now they want to develop their faith. They now want to be a part of this community that they've been learning about in Quran and reading and hadith and just, you know, as people, you know, tell you about their experiences. So they want more, it feeds more into them. Like, yeah, I want to belong here, you know. It's maybe like before they didn't have a place. Maybe like they had families who just didn't understand them. I know like me, my mother and my father are both Muslim, but we didn't always live, you know, Islamic life. And then you go over to your relative's house and they're like, you know, throwing us all this stuff about Christmas, because we didn't celebrate Christmas coming up. You know, although we wasn't practicing Muslim, we did not celebrate Christmas or holidays like the brother said. And people think you're crazy. Like, we don't celebrate that. And it's just like, you think you're the only one there out there. And it's like, when I started learning Islam, it's like, my heart, my soul is saying, this is your place. This is where you belong. You know, and they're just like calling me. And I guess it was Allah was bringing me to, because I kept asking him. You know, I might even say, oh, Allah, but I mean, just my soul kept searching, oh, I want the truth, I want the truth. And he led me through these doors. But when you're here, you want to be a part of something. You want to feel that you're worth something. You want to be a, you know, you want to feel that I'm needed here. You know what I'm saying? Especially if you got the non-Muslim families and even parents and people you live with on a day-to-day, you know what I'm saying? You want, at least when you come into a Muslim community, you want to say, hey, these are my people. I feel secure. I feel loved. You know what I'm saying? But the thing about it is, for some reason, after that Shahada, 3 to 6 months down the line, that faith gone. You're like, where'd that faith go? You know? And it's like, what went wrong then? Maybe the problem rise when we did not give that person a strong example of a Muslim community life.
That's right.
It becomes a disappointment. I know it becomes a disappointment to myself. You know, I know I'm, hope I ain't bumping no heads, but I'm gonna have to talk about it.
Tell the truth.
Yeah.
Tell the truth.
You know, even for those who are Muslim now, you know, who did grow up Muslim, even they feel the same thing. Yeah, my parents talk about this, and they talk about that, and, you know, but they don't see, you know what I'm saying? So, yeah, we are prone to, like, deal with the things outside of Islam, the club, the parties, the drugs, you know, just all the kind of crazy stuff that's out there, because we don't have a sense of belonging here. Everybody wants to feel that they're needed, you know what I'm saying? I know I do. So, there's nothing worth staying. If it's not a strong example, there's nothing worth staying and fighting for, especially, like I said, if that person was looking for placement, to find, like, a purpose. Now, that reality becomes false to them because they don't see the example. See, they believe that if they were within this Muslim community that they've been studying about all this time, and everybody, even the Muslims, when they come across, say, oh, Islam is a place to be, but yet they don't see that strong example, why should they stay? Ain't nothing here. But sure, all this backbiting and all this stuff, you know what I'm saying? And doing charity just to be seen a man and all kind of crazy misleading. You telling me, follow me, don't read and study for yourself. Well, sure, I got that in this life, this crazy Islamic life.
That's right.
So why would I come here and stay and struggle with my brothers and sisters? If they just doing the same, if I don't get that example, they're doing the same thing. I see that. Now, don't get me wrong, everybody ain't perfect. I know I ain't perfect myself. You know, you're going to fall into some stuff. You know, uphill. No, I'm just kidding. But it's important that they see, like, the base of our community strong.
That's right.
And we need to have strength. We can't be saying, 30 and 40, I'll be 30 years old. So I'm like, yeah, we need to start learning, we need to start, this is what we could do to make the community more better, we need to be doing, we need to talk about our problems. Talking about our problems, the problem Muhammad gave, that's enough. We should reflect on that, and we should be active. out everything right about now. You know what I'm saying? It's like, without that strong example, there's no purpose, and there's nothing to offer self, and there's nothing to offer others. See, Allah placed mankind guardians of the creation. And see, I believe, you know, that the way of the soul, man is the guardian of creation. And by the way of soul, man acquires knowledge and Allah's attributes. By the way of soul, we travel to the nearness of Allah. And it's like we create efforts to realize Allah. Soul is the ruler of the body. And soul is accepted by Allah when it keeps clean from things other than Allah. We have issues that need to be addressed. Yeah, that's true. Then comes that action. You know what I'm saying? After this talk, you know, I'm held accountable now. You know what I'm saying, too? What I give out, anything I learn, anytime I pick up the Quran and I read something, you don't eat pork, whatever, I can't do it. I'm held responsible to take upon that action, you know? Like I say, we do have issues that need to be addressed in order to better develop our community. Our Islamic community, like for now and in the future, because, you know, I'm young, I have a child, you know, and I look at her and say, what am I preparing for her by preparing for myself? What example? Because that young lady, she is very smart. She's a premature baby, so y'all know about them preemies.
Yes.
You know, their mind is way above their physical ability. You know what I'm saying? This girl is already talking complete sentences. She's very descriptive, and I'm like, whoa, you know. Now, she called back anything that I do. So I'm like, whoa, I see me. No, I need to check. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, what am I preparing as being an example for her? Hey, me and her relationship, that's like a little Islamic community within itself. Because we're taking that and we're coming into this community. What type of example are we giving each other? We can't just look at on this. We got to look on an individual level, too, you know. At first, I really believe it does start with self, you know. And it's like, we should first, like I said, work on itself for knowledge of the soul, which is the root of the knowledge of Allah. Because when man does not know himself, he does not know Allah. And when we associate things other than Allah, we do drift away from him. We drift away because how are we going to be concentrating on Allah when we concentrate more on TV or making money to Benjamins or with all that kind of crazy stuff. You know what I'm saying? I mean, that takes our mind focus from, you know, other things other than Allah, because the soul is going to be asked and judged, you know? And we got to be aware of these things that we're faced with. It's a lot of evils that's around us trying to keep us from getting near to Allah.
That's right.
This American society alone, man, I got a lot of stuff to talk about, but we didn't get the time, but you know, you know, it's a lot of stuff that we face with. You know, they don't want us to have Allah in our life.
That's,
you know,
right.
It's like, I don't know, like before, like, things used to be, I don't know, people used to be more religious back in the days, you know, way back then. And now it's like everything, it's like they're trying to make our wrongdoings seem pleasing to us.
That's,
you know,
right.
What I'm saying?
That's,
you feel?
Right.
Okay. That's what they're trying to do. You know, it's like, oh, yeah. I mean, just, let me see. There's so many examples, my mind ain't even focused right now, but you guys know, they try to keep us from, you know, growing nearness to our Lord, and because we don't have to meet back up with him, you know, and I want to be together, I want to have my soul together for that, you know, and then in that, I just can't think about myself, I got to think about my brother and my sister, you know what I'm saying, what did I do to make somebody else's life better, what was I kicking out, oh, you worried about yourself, you know, I remember Hadith's sister, good friend of mine, Sister Taka, told me. She was like, and not correct me if I'm wrong, anybody, but she was saying something to the fact that it was a believer, and you know, he was in this town or village or whatever, and he prayed, you know, he fasted a month of Ramadan. He did all those Islamic things he's supposed to do, but for himself, you know, and all around the community was just, you know, about to get destroyed, you know, and as the angel was sent to destroy the community, they said, wait a minute, your believer is there. Mm-hmm. What? You know, yeah, the one that fast and, you know, and do all the charity, all that good stuff. Well, what was he at when his people was going wrong? You know, Hey, because I didn't thought it many times. Oh, I'm sick of this community. I'm about to go. You know. I mean, you know, can't get around the people talking about you, you know, assuming wrong. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, you know. But I know I have this knowledge. You know what I'm saying? So what am I doing to help them? Because maybe they don't know what they're doing. A lot of them don't. A lot of people really believe what they're doing is right. You know what I'm saying? And they can't see it. So it's up to me. It's my responsibility because I am guardian of mankind. Remember that. You know, so it's my responsibility to help them if I can. And it's going to be some that don't want my help. But, you know, you're going to leave them alone. We're going to work on the next one. But I mean, I'm just talking. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm just talking because these are things that I see. You know, and my friends see, and people coming to Islam. You know, that's really delicate with me because I'm not just talking about the person that takes us to hide. I'm talking about that baby that's being born. I'm talking about that child that's growing up in his life. You know, it ain't about just a new Muslim coming through. It's about all Muslims, you know? We really have to be focused on, you know, how we're gonna develop our community and take an action in that development. And like I say, you know, we're in the month of Ramadan, you know? This is a time that Allah has blessed us, you know what I'm saying, to focus on these things and to really see them for what they are and then to take action on it, you know? We need knowledge and stuff, like the brother said earlier, but she gave a good talk, excellent talk. You know, we need knowledge of self, because self will help us to be more aware of what Allah wanted, our purpose, you know, and to help out each other. It's like, I don't know, I'm kind of running out of words right now, but y'all know what I'm talking about. I mean, so many things is around us, you know. We need to really think kind of each other, you know. Think kind of each other. Don't think negative. You know, you always supposed to think. Even I remember in the Quran, you know, it says. And I don't know exactly. I'm just kind of giving you a broad. Please help me out with this. But Aisha had came back to the town or wherever the village where the prophet and everybody was, and she was accompanied by a brother. And you know the thing, right. You know how it is with, you know, brothers. Oh, brothers are supposed to be together. You know the thing. Right. And then, oh, you know, they start thinking horrible stuff. This is the prophet's wife.
That's right.
They already kicking on back. Now, y'all know her character is not like that. This, you know what I'm saying? Y'all, we know this. But we still want to think negative.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying? Even, you know, for myself, I was even just, you know, put in a situation like that. You know? Oh, you know, brother, it's not a good thing to be sick. Brother, escort me home. You know, it's late. You know what I'm saying? And the weather bad, because I take a friend on the west side, you know? But they know our character's good, but yet they still say, oh, I mean, they still think the worst. And they know that brother's character. You know what I'm saying? And they knew me. Oh, yeah, at least I thought they did. You know? You know? And that hurt me. But you have to be very careful what you do, because that hurt my soul real bad. Because it's like all this I put in you and all this respect I have for you, but yet you didn't respect me as your Muslim. That hurt. You do damage when you do things like
that's
that.
Right.
You do mighty damage, especially to these people who, like I say, come into Islam and these children that's growing up, you know, and forcing these crazy ways on each other, you know? I mean, there's no compulsion here in Islam, number one. You know, it's built on faith and will,
that's
you know? And it's like, you're enforcing your ways, you know what I mean? So it's like, your faith is just worthless because it ain't really there because you only doing what somebody telling you, forcing upon you.
That's
you know
right.
what I'm saying? No, I mean, we need to do away with that, you know? Let me see, I got something on that from the Quran. Because I don't want to be, like, talking for myself, you know? I don't want to say nothing just because it sounds good.
Right.
You know, I want to have something to back me up, and, you know? Please, help this get to you. It says, in Surah Rabbah 256, it says, let there no be compulsion in religion. Truth stands out clear from error. Whoever rejects evil and believes in God has grasped the most trustworthy handhold that never breaks, and God hears and knows all things. Okay? So I'm trying to force off. Don't make it easy. You know what I'm saying? Let's love one another. Loving is easy. Hating, shoot, that take work. You know what I'm saying? We got to be all mean, you know? Yeah, we got to find ways why we got to hate this person. I don't hate each other, and I hate. See, I mean, that once my it works my mind too much. You know what I'm saying? It does. But Allah makes it so easy for us. You know, think nice of each other. You know, even, you know, you don't have it now. Just like, you know, the Prophet was Aisha. The only thing I do, it was so easy. Oh, brother just escorted her back to her. She got lost. You know? Oh, the brother was a scared sister because it was late at night. You know, she going on the west side. What if her car breaks down? That's a good brother and that's a good sister. You know? If we don't be aware of these things that we're doing as an individual, you know, so we make a strong effect. And we might say, oh, I don't know what you're doing, I don't even got no purpose. You don't know how strong your placement here in this society is. You affect thousands and thousands of people. Your smile alone, you know how you go by somebody just so mean? I worked at in the car industry. Yeah, you deal with arrogant, mean salesperson. I ain't trying to offend the ones who sell cars, but they are. Mm. You know what I'm saying? I was brought in, me, my little self, to help them, you know, better their sales, through car sales. I had this guy, he been there for like, since he was speaking with some cars since 15. You know what I'm saying? So he, you know, he's up in the 80, he ain't too old. You know, he young, he's still young, like in like his 40s or something. And, oh, you can't tell me what to do. You only 22 years of age. You just got it. What you got to tell me? And here they are, put me in front of these group of men and only one woman. You know what I mean? So it was hard. He gave me such a hard time. He looked at me mean. He said mean things. Every morning, I make it my business to say good morning with a smile. Okay? And they say, well, why are you smiling at him? He just said the nastiest things to you. I'm like, but he don't know. I just came into his domain. You know what I'm saying?
That's right.
He got a lot to share with me because I don't know nothing about cars. Mm-hmm. I know about customer service, that's one, but it's still like I'm invading, you know, coming to his home and rearranging without his permission. Uh-huh. You know what I'm saying? So I had to learn. I wouldn't smile at him. He just, Before I left, this guy, I'm like, I was blown. He came to me and said, you know what, Miss Stanley? Now I want you to teach me about, you know, developing my business and prosper. I said, whoa. You know what I'm saying? I said, whoa. You know, what? Everybody said, what you do with that guy? You know, you got him? I didn't do nothing to him. I was scared of him. I probably just, you know, smiled in fear. I'm serious. So I just want to end in this thing. Let's think the best, and let's start acting as Muslims. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you know, I hope I said something that, you know, stuck, you know. And I hope I didn't say anything that was in my cell, because sometimes that can slip out, too. And please forgive me, you know, on that. And I like to say, I thank you for the time and opportunity you guys gave me. Say, assalamu alaikum.
Praise be to Allah, alhamdulillah. Very inspiring words from the two youth, and I think the biggest thing I got out of Sister Nura's talk is that we need to practice showing love for one another. And the Prophet, the prayers and peace be upon him, said, none of you believe until you love for your brother what you love for yourself. And I immediately thought of that, immediately. As far as the charge, you know, this is a rational religion, you know, and in Surah 33, Ayat 21, God says, we have given you in the Messenger of Allah a excellent example. And in that example, there's a rationale, it's logic, and it's logical. And in the Quran, for the person who gives out a false charge and doesn't have witnesses against his sister, there's a punishment now.
That's right.
You know, for the person who does something like that, they're supposed to get a beating. If not a physical one, at least a tongue lashing.
Right.
You know, that's our religion. We have a rational religion. Does anyone have any questions for the youth? No? Also for the youth, I know there's a small turnout today, but don't let that discourage you. It was excellent, and
right.
Allah says in the Quran that there arise among you a band.
Right.
And it starts off a small number. You know, the Prophet, the praise and peace be upon him, he got the revelation in the month of Ramadan, and he came back. And at the time, the first, he only had two other people who accepted Islam, and that was his first cousin, Ali, and his wife Khadijah. May Allah be pleased with them.